Welcome. This is Information Service Engineering. Lecture number one, Information, Natural Language and the Web. In this last section of the lecture, we are going to talk about the meaning of information and what determines the meaning. How do we get the meaning of an information? First of all, of course, we have to ask ourselves, what is meaning? Meaning is something, of course, that is discussed in philosophy in general, and in particular in the philosophy of language, or metaphysics or metasemantics. So there, meaning is a relationship between two sort of things. On the one hand, we have signs or symbols or words. In general, you say signs, and the kind of things they intend, they express, or they signify. So this then determines the meaning. So the relation between a sign and a specific meaning in that, or intent or expression or signal, this exactly is the meaning. By that definition, words as verbal symbols or nonverbal symbols that we use for nonverbal communication, they are necessarily meaningful. Okay, now to get exactly this mapping between signs and intention means we have to understand it. So again, let's go back to the process of understanding. We have already learned what it means. Understanding, we had this previously, in general, is the ability to grasp the meaning of information. And we have to know that information usually is passed in a message using a specific language from a sender to a receiver. And the receiver only understands this message if and only if the receiver interprets the information correctly. So he must do the correct mapping between the information, so this is the symbols, and their intended meaning. So this is the process of understanding. And there are several factors upon which understanding depends on. And this is on the one hand syntax. This is semantics, context, pragmatics, and experience. We go into this in detail shortly after that. But first, let me tell you, syntax tells you how you create correct sentences out of single symbols. Semantics tells you exactly how I derive the meaning dependent on context. This is everything which surrounds our symbol, our message. This ranges from verbal context in a message up to social or cultural context. And also, of course, the intention of the speaker, of the sender, is important because you can, or if you have different intentions to convey exactly what you mean by that, you are using different kind of utterances. So the same text can be uttered in different or conveyed in different ways. So you can shout it, you can whisper it, whatever. So the pragmatics also is important. And of course, the experience. This means the receiver and the sender, they all have personal experiences by which, of course, their way to understand things is determined. Okay, let's have a closer look on that. We start with syntax. Syntax is the most easiest thing. The term that you see here comes from Greek, so syntaxis, it's Greek and meaning arrangement or ordering. And syntax, you know this from, you know, any kind of languages. If you do grammatics at school, then syntax denotes the study of the principles and processes by which correct sentences are constructed in particular languages. So it means it gives you the rules how I create a so-called well-formed sentence. In artificial languages, in formal languages, so you know this as computer scientists, in a formal language, syntax is just a set of rules by which so-called well-deformed expressions can be created from a fundamental set of symbols. This is the alphabet then in formal languages. So syntax is clear. This gives you the rules, how you construct a well-formed sentence, a correct sentence. Correct sentence does not mean that its meaning has to be correct. I can say the horse has six legs. Of course, everybody knows this is most likely not true. However, this is a correct sentence, which means the syntax of the sentence was correct. So syntax doesn't give you anything about the meaning. Of course, the ordering, how I order my words, my single symbols in a sentence often also conveys meaning, because these words, depending on their position, have different kind of meaning. So therefore, syntax also contributes to meaning. But syntax alone, of course, is not sufficient. You need semantics. This is exactly the mapping, the ordering. So how can I really map the symbol to its intended meaning? This is also a Greek word. Semantics comes from, pertains to the character, the study of meaning. And this is also part of linguistics and focused, of course, on sense and meaning of language and symbols of languages. Semantics is nothing else, if you want to define it, as the study of interpretation of signs or symbols as used by your agents or communities within particular circumstances and contexts. So this means the mapping that we do between the signs, the symbols, and the intended meaning, of course, is also dependent on further properties, like, for example, the context. Another thing that semantics gives you, so as soon as you have determined, let's say, the meaning of a specific word, you have to find out what's the meaning of the entire sentence. So semantics gives you rules how you can derive the sense and the meaning of complex concepts, this is an entire sentence, from simple contexts, concepts, which is, of course, the meaning of a word, for example. And by doing this, they are using syntactic rules. This makes it easy, but for example, simply by using the word no, or if you use negation, then of course you simply turn around the meaning of something. And this means, of course, if you see some statement negated, you turn around exactly the meaning. So this is a syntactic rule by the occurrence of exactly this word. If this word occurs with another concept, you know the meaning of the concept and you have the negation in front, then you turn around the meaning. So this means exactly this last sentence, if you can by that derive or create the sense and meaning of complex concepts from simple concepts. And the rule you take here is a syntactic rule, which tells you exactly what to do if a negation occurs. So this is semantics. However, as I have told you, the mapping between the signs and the intended meaning, so the semantics, is also dependent on further circumstances, like, for example, context and pragmatics. We have seen this already. So what is context? So here the only word that is given in Latin. So contextus means interweaved. That is a Latin word. And context denotes everything. The surrounding of a symbol or a concept in an expression. Also its relationship with surrounding expressions and further related elements. So this is the so-called verbal context. But there is more. Context denotes all elements of any sort of communication that define the interpretation of the communicated content. So for example, we have social context. Depending in which, let's say, social group you are, the meaning of what you say might change. Or you, if you convey something in different social contexts, the way how you do this also will differ, although you have the exact same intention. So context, definitely social context, contributes to semantics. Another thing is the temporal context. Temporal context is really, really important. So if I say, let's eat something now. In the morning, this means breakfast. In the evening, this means dinner. On another hand, of course, temporal context, if you say something today, let's say you are talking about a mobile, and you take a person, let's say 100 or 150 years ago, and talk about a mobile, of course, this person will have no idea, since this person comes from another temporal context. And there is a cultural context too. So this means in different cultures, people speaking different languages, they might be used to express the same thing in complete different way. And probably if you say something translated literally, another cultural context would mean then in the end, oh, they understand it in a complete different way. So there are many different ways of context that contribute to the meaning. And the second thing that we have to consider is the pragmatics. The pragmatics is also a Greek word, comes from pragma, action. And this reflects the intention by which the language is used to communicate the message. So in linguistics, pragmatics denotes the study of applying language in different situations, and it denotes the intended purpose of the speaker. In this way, pragmatics studies the way in which context contributes to meaning. So I might say, if I have different intentions and I say exactly the same, I can, by the way how I say it, convey complete different intentions. And this is again how pragmatics contributes to the correct interpretation of meaning. However, the line or the boundary between semantics and pragmatics, it's floating and often is open for debate. So therefore, for this lecture, what we say is, for semantics, we simply look at the literal meaning of a sentence, while pragmatics investigates the meaning of an utterance, that is, the use of the sentence. Let's take three example sentences here. So let's say the first one is, stand up, Bob. So this is imperative, that's a command. And it can mean, of course, that Bob should get up. It could also mean that Bob, you know, should start doing something against something. So it has several meanings. And the meaning is different from, could you please stand up, Bob, which is a polite question. So this is interrogative. And I can also simply say, Bob stands up. But this, of course, has another meaning, because this describes an action going on. So the question of all whether all these three sentences do have the same meaning is clear. Sure, they don't. But of course, what is it what makes them different? And this is, of course, the intention by which they are formed. And the last thing that contributes on both sides, sender and receiver, to understand each other and to convey meaning correctly is their experience. Experience considers all the information that you have learned and put in context with the world you are living in. So this is usually referred to as common sense knowledge, or also as world knowledge. So the experience of the sender and the experience of the receiver, they should have an intersection. If we have completely different experiences, then probably also our contexts, our social, our cultural, our temporal contexts are different. And then understanding becomes much, much, much more difficult. So how or what is now necessary for successful communication? First of all, the information has to be correctly transmitted. So the syntax must be correct in the end. And then, of course, also the meaning, the semantics of the transmitted information must be interpreted correctly. This we know. So the message should be correctly understood. And this understanding, again, we know already now, depends on context for both sender and receiver and the pragmatics of the receiver. And of course, also then the ability of the receiver to interpret the intention of the sender correctly. And of course, the context of the sender and the receiver, they both, again, we have heard that, depend on the experience of their knowledge of the world of both sender and receiver. So how does this now work, that I map a specific meaning to a symbol? So let's take a specific symbol. So here we have jaguar. We have chosen this because it's ambiguous and it can stand for different objects of the real world. So jaguar could stand for, let's say, the sports car, or it could stand for the cat, or it could also stand for an operating system of Apple that doesn't exist anymore. So symbols usually are references for things, for objects of the real world. And these objects don't have to be concrete. They can also be abstract concepts, like, for example, love. On the other hand, as soon as I say this symbol, as soon as I say jaguar, something pops up in your head. When you hear it, you understand it, and you say, ah. If you don't have context, you think of, yeah, either the sports car or you think of the cat, so of one of both. However, what you see there in your head is not a real existing specific cat or jaguar car. It's, let's say, something like the archetype of a jaguar, the archetype of a car, which is a jaguar. So this is then the concept. And this concept usually refers to specific objects in the real world. So this kind of triangle that you see here is the so-called semiotic triangle, which comes from Ogden Richards from the 1920s. However, In principle, it dates back to antiquity and to Aristotle as a philosopher. Looking at it from the point of semiotics, what is semiotics? Semiotics is an investigation into how meaning is created and how meaning is communicated. So its origins lie in the academic study of how signs, symbols create meaning. And it has been introduced by Ferdinand de Saussure, a Swiss linguist, a so-called semiotician, and also a philosopher. So his ideas laid the foundation for many significant developments in both linguistics and semiotics in the 20th century. You start there in semiotics with an utterance. You say, if you can read this kind of alphabet, you say chair. So you have a concrete sound pattern. Chair stands for a specific signifier. So chair signifies something, which stands for a concrete object. So you say something chair, which is arbitrary. However, this stands for something concrete, an object, which is this blue chair, for example. On the other hand, this signifier evocates or evokes something which is signified. So this is the concept, an abstract concept from the last page, which is the archetype of a chair. However, this archetype refers to a specific object we have here. So this is the so-called dyadic model by Ferdinand de Saussure, which refers to how meaning is transferred or associated with a symbol, or here an utterance, a concrete sound pattern. Okay, now you have learned a lot of how meaning of information really is created and what factors contribute to that kind of meaning. So this is really important. It's important for successful communication. And communication is nothing but the result of consistent social agreement, which means if sender and receiver would have different abstract concepts in their head about what exactly now a concrete sound pattern might mean, then of course communication will not work anymore. Okay, now you have mastered the entire first lecture. We started in the first-hand side that we thought about how do we get information from the web. We learned about the knowledge graph and search engines. We were talking about communication, language, and understanding, especially how information can be quantified, can be measured. And we saw that in this huge universe of the web, search engines, of course, are really, really important to get information. However, search engines have problems, especially by the use of natural language, which introduce a lot of ambiguity, or let's say expressions, different expressions for exactly the same thing, so homonyms, for example. And by that, we came up that it's important to determine the meaning of information, because the process of understanding that we were talking about, you remember, understanding means correct interpretation of information. This is dependent on a few factors, which are syntax, semantics, context, pragmatics, as well as experience. And by that, I leave you now for the end of the first lecture. And in the next lecture, you will see we will start with natural language processing.